So good evening, everyone. Let's introduce who we are. We are kiwi.com. We can find unique flights option. So, and we can offer these options to you. So we have 100 million daily searches, 50K sold seats per day, and billions of daily price checks. So we can say we have data, right? And who I am? I'm Marian Špilka, I'm senior data engineering, and I'm a part of the data platform team. As I said, we have data, so we have a big data. We have many data teams. So, and by presenting this topic, I would like to help you if you struggle with credentials issues, or you have a password stored in your code or something like this. So I would like to help you with this. And also, if you would like to make your newcomers reach their potential as fast as possible, I hope I will solve this by this presentation. So for illustration, for this presentation, let's call these newcomers with the name Bob. So who is Bob? I will tell you a sad story about Bob. Bob is a newcomer, and he is very talented. He is very skilled. So this is his very first task, to create an airflow deck which transfers data from Postgres database and insert them into BigQuery. Our Bob is very skilled, so okay. He accepted the challenge, so he asked the question, how do I get to the Postgres database? Good question. So he wrote an email to the security department. Hello, could you provide me with the database credentials? And he was waiting 1 hour, 2 hours, no answer. And after 24 hours, finally, yes, after 24 hours, he wrote another email. Hello, is there any update regarding my credentials? I'm stuck. And again, he's waiting, but finally he got the credentials, but they didn't work. Permission denied for public schema. Oh, so he wrote another email. Hello, could you please grant me an access to public schema? After 24 hours, he added the manager in the CC. So the response was very prompt, and finally he had correct accesses. But there is another question. Ouch, I need access BigQuery too. So our Bob decided to ask Tim, hey Tim, could you share with me credentials to BigQuery? And after 1 week, there is a question from his Bob, from his boss. Hey Bob, how are you with your very first task? Any ETA? And our Bob is very sad because he's very talented, skilled. He knows how to build the data pipelines, but he was stuck for a whole week because of the credentials. And let's be honest now. Have you experienced something similar as Bob? Yeah, I can feel that frustration. I think we all have been there, right? We all have been there, yes. The frustration that you would like to code, you're ready to provide your talent and provide code, and you're stuck. So let's analyze Bob's working environment. Yes, our Bob was stuck, and he's not a very happy developer. So there is poor developer experience. Slow project delivery. The project was blocked for a whole 1 week. Oh, production is in danger. Why? Because our Bob can touch production from his local machine now. I don't think he is ready to wipe out the whole production database. And there is no transparency. He was asking, and no one knows who has an access where, right? And the last question here is, who knows where those shared credentials ended up at the list, right? So you can feel that this is not good. And what if I told you there is a better way? A way which make access secure, efficient, and dare I say, enjoyable. So let's make our dev life easier. And I will show you our solution in our company, but I think this solution is common solution right nowadays. So we stand on four pillars. The first pillar is identity and access management. The second pillar is application default credentials. The third pillar is workload identity federation. And the fourth pillar is impersonation feature. Don't worry, we will go pillar by pillar, and I will tell you more. So the first pillar, identity and access management. We have all our infrastructure seats in Google Cloud, but I think this is very common approach. So what is it? This is a concept which consists of two entities, identities such as users, groups, services, and also machines, we can say. And the second entity is roles. Role is just a set of permissions. And I think most of you have already an experience with this. For example, we can take a use case when you would like to share a Google Doc like this. You have to pick users or groups, and also you have to select a role, like viewer, commenter, editor. So this is the identity and access management in reality, right? And we do the same in our company, but we have infrastructure as a code. So we have this code. This is Terraform code. And we can easily set that this data set, for the data set, we define these users, groups, service accounts, and et cetera. And we are assigning a role. So very the same. Let's go to the second pillar. The second pillar is application default credentials. It is just a strategy which automatically finds appropriate application credentials based on the application environment. So let's have an application which uses cloud resources. And when we provide to this application credentials, user credentials, then this application can run under these credentials, right? The application is using credentials, using identity of some user or some service. So this is the second pillar of our solution. Let's move on. The third pillar is workload identity federation. So we are running our applications in cloud, in Kubernetes. So this is just a way how to make the previous pillar feasible for Kubernetes. So we have a Kubernetes, and there are applications, right? In Kubernetes jargon, it is work, there are workloads. And we are just assigning for each workload its own identity. So there is a federation between Kubernetes and cloud. So applications can touch cloud resources. And it is compatible with identity and access management, which I have already mentioned. So that's great. Now, applications which is running in cloud has its own identity, its own account, and it is working. So this is the third pillar. And there is a problem, like, okay, we have an application which is running in Kubernetes with some identity. But we have to remember that we have a Bob, and our Bob is working from his local machine. And he would like to create a data pipeline. So how to achieve this, let's say, workload identity federation in Docker on his local host? How to achieve this? And for this, we provided a small hack, let's say. So firstly, we have to log in our application environment, so our localhost. So when we run this command, there here is Bob, which is running this command, and he's asking Cloud to trigger a login phase. So the login page will be opened, Bob can write his name and password, and then the credential file is downloaded or created on his machine, and it is stored in this file path. So now his app local machine is logged in Google Cloud, and each application which is running on his local machine can touch Google or cloud resources. But we have to remember that our Bob is working, or application is running in Docker. So how to transfer this file to Docker? So this is the second part of this hack, that we can use Google, we can use Docker volume sharing feature. So simply we just share the credential file, which is stored in this file path, and we can share it with a Docker container. And now Docker container can act as Bob with Bob's identity. Like this. Great. So let's move on to the very last pillar. Service account impersonation. Oh, impersonation, what does it mean? It is very simple. You can act as someone else. It's a very strong sentence, I know. So how it is achieved? When in the cloud, you can have a rule that Bob can generate a credential token of someone else or some other service account. So this is a rule in cloud, it is stored. So he has a permission for it. And when he has a permission for it, he can easily ask to be impersonated to use different identity. And now I think it's time for a question. Why? Why it is good for, right? Why we need avatar account, and why we need this whole impersonation? And I will clarify this in the very next slide. And in the very next slide, oh, just give me a sec. So about the impersonation, when we have an application running under Bob's identity, the consequence of the impersonation is that suddenly the application can just use different identity based on the code. So application can run as someone else. And now there is a question why, right? And I will clarify it in the very next slide. So we propose a solution for Bob's company. So this is a setup of the infrastructure for test environment. And we defined here three rules again. The very first rule is that Bob's belongs to develop group of developers. The second rule is that we can create just avatar empty service account, it is account, which can access test services. And now is coming the impersonation, and this is why we need impersonation, is that everyone from devel group and test environment can act as test service account. And that's it. And what's the consequence of this? Is that application which is running under Bob's identity, suddenly, when it is necessary, can use test service account to access test services. So Bob can access test services directly, but transitively, yes. And also the same situation is for test deployment. So now you can see the cloud and local environment are unified, right? So let's move on production environment. How should it look like? So we have here only two rules. The first rule is production service account accesses production services. And production deployment can act as production service account. So the consequence is that only production deployment through the production service account can touch production services. So production database or production services are safe. Okay, so let's go to the benefits where we can feel the help of this solution. So the code is totally safe without any credentials. It can be versioned in Git, and there is like no issue with them. As I said, we have one code, but this code behaves differently on test, on production, but this is just one code. Bob is very happy now. He is unblocked. Maybe he's writing his code. So I can't think of better dev experience, which leads me to another point that once the newcomer is onboarded, so that rule that Bob is a part of the develop group, this rule is applied automatically during the onboarding process. So then our Bob just can come to the office, sit down and work without any block. And production is safe with no problem. No one can touch the production. And this solution also helps us to implement data mesh architecture. So each team can have its own setup. Now I will tell you like real life benefits, except those in our company. We significantly decreased number of service desk requests, right? There were many requests like, it is not working, hey, please help me. It is not working, and et cetera. Another thing is that when you think about that, we have many teams. We have 36 separate Airflow instances over 27 data teams, right? So let's say it is like maybe 100 people. And when we save just 1 hour per sprint for each one, we save 100 hours of headache. So this is another benefit. Also, we have like the highest security standards, and when we have no passwords, like we are proof, we are safe. When you have a password, you have to change it like after some time, so we are safe also. So look at him, our Bob is happy now, so he finished his very first task, and he is ready to take another one. If you would like to follow more technological or tech stuff or some events, so check out our code.kiwi.com site, and please come to our booth, stop by, and we can talk. I would like to thank you all, and also I would like to thank Kiwi, which supported me during the preparation of this talk. So that's it from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marian. Please, if you have any question, kindly walk up to the microphone and he would answer.
Hey, thank you so much for the presentation. It was great. I have two questions. While creating a workload identity federation pool, we have to provide the issuer URL. So this issuer URL is only for valid. It will be only present for a valid valid providers. So if I want to use workload identity federation in some local host or something or somewhere, how do I need to create a issuer URL?
a URL of when you would like to use the workload identity provider, or?
Yes.
Like this was set up by our infra team, mm-hmm. so we just use it because we have Airflow instances in Kubernetes, mm-hmm. and it was set up by them. So maybe you can stop by our booth and I can forward this question to them.
Okay. The second one is regarding impersonation. So we know that we can have this cross project impersonation. For suppose if I being in a project A and I want to impersonate to a service principal or service account in project B, I can do that. Is it something possible in cross organization level?
Oh, I don't think so. That is it possible because in Google Cloud Platform there is one organization and we have like more projects. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure if it is possible. Maybe okay. This is also the question for our infra team, which they set it up.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation. So if I understand correctly, you end up having one account that any developer or service impersonates into mm-hmm. to access your system. But what about in your system you have sensitive data? Anyone in the team, as well as the process, has access to all sensitive data?
Yeah, you can define another service account with the permission to touch sensitive data, and you can secure the access to the impersonation for this extra service account.
But then you will not have the same account for the service and for the restricted area of the information, is it? You will
no.
have. I mean, if you are restricting the access of one product user. I mean, who is called the service account, and you will have two of them, one for restricted data and one for not.
Mm-hmm.
But then, how do you manage so that the developers or in the testing, you can test the service without accessing the sensitive data? Is there a mismatching that I don't know how to handle?
Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe you can have like test environment with anonymized data, so you can build the solution on that, and then you can deploy your code to production, and only production has the access to the sensitive data. Maybe this is the solution for it.
Mm, yeah. Okay. Thank you.
How does this compare to the RBAC approach?
Oh, once again, to the approach?
Role-based access management.
Sorry, again?
Well, you know, usually this sort of issue is being solved by, you know, assigning specific roles to team members and virtual agents and so on. And, I mean, how would you compare the RBAC approach, the role-based access approach, to this mimic-like approach that you have described? Like, what would you say are the key differences between the two?
Sorry, I still didn't get your question. Maybe we can talk about
that. Okay, okay.
Thanks.
Seems like there are no more questions. Shall we applaud him?